Hello, 4190. Greetings from Japan. Actually, I'm not in Japan. I'm in my office. But while you're watching this, I may be in Japan. So this is the lecture, video lecture that goes along with class for October 15th, week 8. And we're going to talk about phrasing editorial comments. So one of the things you're going to have to do in all of the projects that we have from here until the end of the semester, but in particular for your job materials and your so the resume and cover letter, is you're going to have to edit the document, but within the document you're going to have to use the Microsoft Word track changes feature and the Microsoft Word comments feature. And the comment feature allows you to leave comments for the writer. Okay, so you can tell them things like, here's the change I made. You really need to work on X, Y, and Z, so on and so forth. So what I want to talk about today is how can we phrase those comments in order to best foster a good working relationship between the writer and the editor. Okay, so this is based on a reading that hopefully you all have done so far. Boom, there it is. Linguistic Strategies for Balancing Clarity and Politeness. This is by Joe Makowitz and Catherine Riley, both of whom were professors in my graduate program. They do great work, and so this is a really great sort of theoretical and practical article. More importantly, it's really practical for editors, and really easy for students, to sort of implement some of these strategies. So if you haven't already read this, which is also posted on the course website under the October 15th class period. If you have not already read this, you should. You not you sh it's not you should, you must. That's part of the reading. Read this article. It'll make this video lecture is meant to complement or supplement that article, so it'll make a whole lot more sense if you've read the article already. Okay. What I want to do though in this video lecture is I want to focus on a few things. I'm going to walk through theoretically what is linguistic politeness, practically how does that apply to editors, and then more importantly at the very end, I'm going to walk through a sample resume that I've edited for a client, for an actual client. And I wanted to show you this for two reasons. One, just to give you an example of sort of my expectations for this project. So what does an edited resume actually look like? And I'll post that on the resources page of the website. And then secondly, I want to walk through specifically the different comments that I left the writer. So in light of linguistic politeness, I want to show you some examples in action of here are some comments I left for the writer. Here are the different linguistic politeness strategies that I've used. Okay, so let's dive in. So linguistic politeness theory, without getting overly theoretical, I just want to give you a little bit of foundation. So it's a linguistic theory that was founded by Brown and Levinson in 1987. And really it's based on a previous theory called speech act theory, which is founded in the branch of pragmatics. It's a linguistics branch. So all of that to say, not that important for you practically, just want to give you a little bit of foundation. Basically, what speech act theory says is all utterances perform two things. One, a locutionary act, which is the literal act of saying something, and two, an illocutionary act, which is sort of the intent or the underlying meaning, right? So a phrase like, does this need salt, literally is a question. Like, it's literally a yes/no question, right? But if you're eating a steak that's really dry and not tasty, and you think it actually does need salt, but you don't want to offend the person that cooked the steak, you might say something like, does this need salt? And you're not actually asking a yes or no question. You're suggesting that this terrible piece of steak actually does need salt. Okay, so you see this happening all the time in everyday speech. You see this happening all the time in email interaction, just in all of the different interactions that you have on a day-to-day basis. The things that you say or write have a locutionary act, a literal act of saying or writing something, and an illocutionary act. What is the intended meaning? Okay, so understanding the difference between those things is going to be important as we go through and talk about linguistic politeness theory. So linguistic politeness theory is really, really foundationally built on this idea that every human being has what is known as face. And Goffman defines face as positive self-image. Okay, so you've probably heard this term in the context of the saying, you know, he or she tried to save face, right? He was trying to save face. And it's actually a term that's highly used culturally by Eastern cultures, this idea of face-saving acts. But in the realm of linguistic politeness, face is just positive self-image, right? So every human being has face, and every human being seeks to preserve their own face. But also, if they're rational and if they're being polite, they seek to preserve the face of others, the people that they're talking to, right? So usually, in most cases, you're not trying to just embarrass someone, right? You're trying to, what politeness does is it preserves the face of that person, even if you have to deliver bad news to them, right? Like, you did terrible on this exam. There's different ways you can say that sort of saves the person's face, or at least preserves some of their face, right? So saying things like, there are areas where you can improve on this exam, right? This exam exposes lots of different opportunities for you to improve, as opposed to you did terrible. So face is positive self-image. There's different types of face. So negative face is the need for autonomy or individualism. So this idea of, you know, I am individualistic, I don't want you to impose on my will, right? So when you tell someone to do something, so, hey, you, send me the email, you're imposing on their autonomy, right? So their free will to decide whether or not to actually send you the email is imposed on when you tell them to do something. So that's an example of negative face being imposed on, upon. And then there's positive face. This idea of a need for social approval, a need to be a part of a larger group. So this idea sort of a collectivist culture or a collectivist ideal. So for example, excluding someone. So you're not part of this group, so you don't have to perform X, Y, and Z. That's an example of impeding or threatening positive face. Okay, so that those ideas of face and face-threatening acts are important because, as writers and editors, there's this inherent relationship that's sort of contentious, right? So this idea of I'm a writer, I spent the last year working on this document, or I spent the last month working on this document, whatever. I put a lot of hard work, sweat, blood, sweat, and tears into it. I don't want you to butcher it. I don't want you to change it. So writers don't want editors to demand a single solution, right? So the editor's saying, well, we should phrase it this way. And the writer's saying, well, that's not necessarily true. I want to phrase it this way, right? So they don't necessarily want a single solution. Editors can be seen as controlling or taking control of a paper, right? So I'd written it this way. When I got the edits back, it looks completely different, right? It doesn't even sound like the way I've written this article. And so because of this relationship, it's important for editors to not only be language experts. So all of the stuff we've learned up to this point, right? How to properly use a comma, semicolon, a colon, an em dash, and em dash, right? So how to properly use punctuation, how to properly use structure sentences grammatically. All of that's important, but you also need, as an editor, to be able to be a diplomat, to be someone that can manage a relationship with the writer well. And so when we talk about face, this idea of everyone has this face or this positive self-image, editing is inherently a face-threatening act, right? So you're telling the writer to make a change. You're saying, this content is not good enough. It needs more detail, right? Now you're impeding on their negative face, right? Their individualism or their autonomy. The writer is thinking, well, isn't it my right to put whatever I want in my resume? And the editor is saying, no, you should, you know, you need to add this information. The job ad is looking for this information, right? So that's inherently a negative face-threatening act. Or criticizing a writer explicitly or implicitly, right? So by saying, man, you've got 20 mistakes here and they're all the same sort of comma mistake, you're impeding their positive face in that you're saying, well, you're not really part of this writing community. You're not really a writer. Or it can be construed that way, right? Like, you're not good enough. You're not one of us. We're editors. We're really good with language, and you're not really good with language, right? So editing has this inherent sort of both negative and positive face-threatening ability. So where does politeness come into play? Linguistic politeness refers to using language to tend to, and by tend to, I mean to mitigate or to lessen the impact of positive and negative face threats, or to tend to positive and negative face needs. Okay, so really what politeness does is it gives editors the tool of language to manage these relationships. So if we know that we're going to impede on someone's positive and negative face, we can use language then to say, okay, we can intentionally try not to offend these people. And so that is where linguistic politeness sort of comes into play for editors. Okay, so hopefully that wasn't too bad in terms of theory. I just wanted to give you some, lay the groundwork for kind of why we're looking at linguistic politeness theory in the first place. But then now I want to move to sort of the second half of the article, the Makowitz and Riley article, where they walk through the different strategies. And this is where it becomes really practical for you. And so what we want to do is, we already talked about that. What we want to do is we want to talk about the different strategies. So the first thing that Makowitz and Riley sort of lay out are what are called levels of directness, right? So there's different ways to say the same thing, right? We all know this. This happens to us all the time. So there's the direct way, which is the most unambiguous way. And so if someone said, for example, include a table here, that's very direct, right? Like that can't be misconstrued. That can't be misinterpreted. It simply says include a table. So that's the most direct. And then there's conventionally indirect. And this creates pragmatic ambiguity. That's just a fancy way of saying this creates two possible meanings, right? So if you say, can you include a table? You include meaning one, which is the literal meaning. So the person that's actually reading this comment might say, yes, I can include a table. And it can just end there. It can terminate there. Right, so it can be interpreted as just a yes or no question. Or the second possible meaning is you need to include a table here. Right, it's not a question at all. It's just a polite way of saying include a table. Right, but without sort of other linguistic cues, we're not sure necessarily, a reader of that comment is not necessarily sure whether or not it's meaning one or meaning two. Okay, so that's conventionally indirect. And then non-conventionally indirect creates pragmatic vagueness. Again, that's just a fancy way of saying it creates lots of different meanings, lots of different possible meanings. And so this is things you would categorize into this are things like passive-aggressive statements. So things that you think about that are passive-aggressive. Graphic aids create interest, right? So like it's just this vague statement, but they're really trying to get you to add a table. That is an example of a hint, right? We're hinting at something, but we're not really getting at what we're trying to say. So those are the three levels of directness: direct, conventionally indirect, and non-conventionally indirect. For each of those three levels of directness, there are strategies we can do to make them more polite, okay? There are basically two categories of strategies. There's downgraders, and this is, again, if you haven't read the Mackiewicz and Riley article, you'll need to. But there's downgraders, and there are supportive moves. Okay, so basically two categories of politeness markers, ways to make things more polite. So downgraders are ways to sort of downgrade the face-threatening act. So these can be added to both direct and indirect utterances, and they can be stacked. So you can add these on top of each other. So I think you should add a table here. I think you should possibly add a table here. That, you know, we're stacking, I think, which is a subjectivizer, and possibly, which is a downtoner, right? It's less important that you've memorized all of these different examples: subjectivizer, hedge, downtoner, appealer, cajoler. And it's more important to understand downgraders simply are just ways to lexical or phrasal words that you can add to a statement to make them more polite. That's sort of what it boils down to. And then there are what are called supportive moves, which are can also be added to indirect and direct strategies. But these add actually new semantic content. So these are like entirely new phrases or sentences, as opposed to the supportive or as opposed to the downgrader, which are just, you know, one word or one or two words. Okay, so that's the main difference. There are two supportive moves that are really sort of prevalent for editors. One is the payoff statement, right? So telling the writer why they should make the change, right? So this will help your reader find your work experience more easily, right? So that's a payoff statement. Maybe I'll say something like, you should move your work experience to the top of your resume, and then you can add the payoff statement. This will help the reader find your work experience more easily. So that's a payoff statement. And then the second is the compliment. The compliment is always a good way to preface a potentially face-threatening act, right? So this is a good start, but I would move the work experience to the top of your resume, right? So bookending something or starting something with a compliment and then presenting the potential change. Okay, so let's talk about, in addition to those, there's different ways that direct statements can be different ways that direct statements can be communicated. So again, just as a reminder, a direct statement is something like include a table, right? So one meaning, it can't be misunderstood or misinterpreted. It's just direct. So there's bald on record, locution derivable, and opinion statement. Now, again, these are three fancy words that are three fancy terms that I don't really care whether or not you know them. I just care that you know there's different ways to present direct strategies. Okay, so bald on record. An example is insert work experience here, right? This is the most clear, right? Can never be misunderstood. It can never be misinterpreted. It's also the most face-threatening. So when we think about politeness and clarity, so things that can't be misunderstood, it's sort of a continuum. So things that are very clear are almost always very face-threatening, and things that are very unclear are almost always much less face-threatening. Okay? So it's sort of this continuum. So bald on record is the most face-threatening. Some non-native speakers will actually prefer bald on record, right? So they will prefer not to have to interpret what you're trying to say and instead just be being told what to do. Right, just move the table here. Suggestions for bald on record: add downgraders. So that idea of adding that list of downgraders that I posted earlier in the video, adding those is helpful, right? So insert work experience here, and then adding okay to the end of it. That's an example of making it a little more polite. You can also mitigate it with compliments, right? So I've like what you've listed here, but insert work experience prior to it, or mitigate it with a payoff statement. Insert work experience here, the reader will be able to access it more easily, right? So give them a reason while you're telling them to do something, okay? That's bold on record. Another way to be direct is to use these high-value modal verbs. High-value modal verbs, again, fancy language. Verbs that are should, will, or ought, okay? So for example, you should include your work experience here. So you can see that's different than insert work experience here, okay? So you should include your work experience here. Some of the suggestions for using locution derivable, so using these modal verbs should, will, or ought, that are provided by Makowitz and Riley. Avoid passive voice. So the table ought to be inserted here. Avoid that. But we can mitigate with downgraders. So for example, you know, you should include a table here. That makes it a little more polite. Mitigate with a complement. So this content is good for this section, but you should include a table here. Or mitigate with a payoff statement. You should include a table here. It will make it easier for the audience. Okay, you'll see often these two things, the payoff statement and the complement. These are very helpful, right? Like, it's important to be clear. And so if you want to be clear, the best way to do it is just to be direct, but then to also include either a complement or a payoff statement. Okay. Finally is the opinion strategy statement. I use this one a lot. So this changes the point of view from the writer to the editor, okay, while remaining direct and unambiguous. So instead of put your work experience here, change it to I would put my work experience before education, right? So as an expert, I would do this, right? So the opinion statement is very direct, but it also is less face-threatening because you're not really telling the person directly, you do this. You're saying, I would do this, okay? If it were me, I would do this, okay? I would suggest using them, and Makowitz and Riley would also suggest using them. Okay, so some indirect strategies. So again, we just went through some direct strategies, so ways to be very straightforward and unambiguous. Conventionally indirect strategies we should only use indirect strategies when something is not required. Okay, so if you're actually giving the writer an option, right, like you could move the table here, but if you don't want to, you don't have to. If that's an actual option, then we can use indirect strategies. But if you're saying you must move the table, then we want to avoid indirect strategies. Okay. So there's basically two kinds of indirect strategies. One is using these low-value modal verbs. So these modal verbs of can and could. So for example, you could insert your work experience here, right? So that's you can kind of tell that that's different than, I did something weird. You can kind of tell that that's different than you should insert your work experience here, right? Should and could have different obligation statements or obligation inferences for the reader. So you could is much more indirect than you should, okay? Suggestions. Avoid these, as I said earlier, to convey obligation, right? So only use these if there is actually a possibility or option, right? So you could remove your references, but if you don't want to, you don't have to. Versus remove your references, right? Those are two very different things. So we want to save this indirect strategy of using these low-value modal verbs, can and could, when it actually is optional. And then finally, there's the interrogative strategy. And this is basically phrasing a direct command as a question. Okay, so can you include your work experience here versus include your work experience here? Okay, again, suggestions for this. Avoid when obligation is intended, right? So if you want to tell the writer, hey, you need to move the work experience, then you want to avoid phrasing it as a question because it can be interpreted as a question. So we want to reserve this for actual inquiries, right? Can you include more information for each work entry? That's an actual question, right? Because the person might actually not be able to include that information. And then finally, non-conventionally indirect. I won't spend a lot of time. These are hints, right? So this section has a lot of info, or tables can help you when you have a lot of info. The suggestion for this is just to avoid them, right? It has too many intended meanings, too many possible meanings, so we're just going to avoid hints. Okay. To convey possibility, this is the last thing I'll cover. So if you're saying, you know, you might want to include information about your work experience, and you want to be very explicit that this is just an option, this is not an obligation, you can just be explicitly state that, right? So you might want to include more information about your work experience, this is just a suggestion, right? So if you want to be as clear as day for the writer, that's one option. That's one option that Mackiewicz and Riley also include. Okay, so that's linguistic politeness. That's phrasing things. I hope that was helpful. I know there's a lot of sort of theory and foundational things that we talked about, but I think it's really important for you to understand sort of the reasoning why we would want to phrase things the way we want to phrase things. Okay. So what I want to do now is I want to walk through really quickly and not in too much detail. I'm going to post this. This can be posted to the course website under resources so that you have an example of, you know, what does an edited resume actually look like? Like, what am I looking for? And so what we're going to see here is, and you'll be able to see this on the website, is a resume that I've edited for an actual client, and you can kind of see all of the different edits, so in track changes. So, you know, lots of different edits, lots of changes. What I want to do is I want to just show you some of the comments that I've made so you can actually see, these linguistic politeness strategies in action. And the computer wants to die, so we'll see if we can get through this thing here. So I want to just show you the comments without all of that crazy markup. So let me move this over a little bit and move this over a little bit. Okay. So hopefully you can see this. So here is the first comment, and I'll just read it and then sort of describe to you, frame it in sort of the discussion of linguistic politeness. So in resumes, it's always useful to follow a show don't tell method for conveying information. Instead of telling your audience you are committed, is there any way you can possibly use this bullet point to show the audience your commitment? Perhaps adding some measurable information like the number of years you've provided high quality services. Okay, so a couple things. One, you'll notice this is phrased as a question. And so the reason why this is phrased as a question, because it's actually a question. I'm actually querying the author. I'm not telling him or her to do this specifically. I'm just saying, if you have this information, like if you have the number of years you've provided high quality service, I think you should add it. So again, that's that indirect strategy, you know, phrasing something as a question when it's actually a question. Let's see, here's another comment. The content in your summary is well written, so there's a compliment. However, I have placed your summary into bullet points and made the list parallel. This will allow the audience to more easily scan the document and hit the main points without wading through the text in paragraph form. Okay, so two things here. One, compliment, and two, a payoff statement. This will allow the audience to more easily scan the document. So giving the writer a reason why you've made the change. So I've told him I'm making this change. it's already made, but here are the reasons why. Okay? So just a little more linguistic politeness. Comment three, you mentioned patient positioning and restocking supplies. Perhaps there are two, these are two different in terms of responsibility. Consider separating the two activities into multiple bullet points. Again, this is an option. So I've phrased it as optional, because I didn't think, for as an editor, I didn't think it was my call to make them two different bullet points. I thought that was the writer's call, so I left it up to the writer. Could this perhaps be combined with your previous bullet point? So again, this idea of should we be combining these things? But again, as an editor, I didn't feel comfortable just removing information, just deleting stuff. So I left it up to the author. Perhaps you need to consider doing this. I'm going to skip down to number six. So here's another. I'm not sure this is the best verb here, but I'll defer to you since you're the subject matter expert. So again, I don't know enough about radiology to know whether or not this is the correct verb, but I don't think it's a great verb. So I'm telling that to the writer explicitly. And the last one I'll look at. In order to keep your, I'll look at two more. In order to keep your resume consistent, I would add the company title here as well. Okay, so that's that direct strategy with those high-value modal verbs, would. So I use that verb would, and then that's also that strategy of the opinion statement, right? So that where you interject your own opinion as opposed to telling the writer exactly what they should be doing. So I would add the company title here as well. So I'm directly telling the writer you need to add the company info, but I'm phrasing it in a way that is less face-threatening. And then the last one I'll look at is number nine. As you'll notice, I've restructured the way your education is presented. It makes your credentials much easier to scan. Okay, so I made a change. It was a fairly major change. And so I use this payoff statement again. It makes your credentials much easier to scan. That just provides, again, a reason for the change that I've made. And it makes the change much less face-threatening. Okay, you can go through all of these comments on your own time, and just see how I'll phrase them. You'll be graded on the way you phrase your comments, so it'll be important for you to think through your comments carefully. And the last thing I want to talk about really quickly, you'll notice that there's 11 comments in this resume. There's way more than 11 edits. So I've edited, there's probably 100 edits in this resume, right? Things like fixing grammar, fixing punctuation, fixing misspelled words. I'm only using the comment feature, so I'm only adding a comment. And just as a recap, you can add a comment by highlighting what you want to comment and then clicking on the, sorry, we're out of the screen here, clicking on the new button here under comments when you're reviewing the document, and that will allow you to write and leave a comment. But I'm only leaving a comment for edits that were moderate or large. So moderate changes or large changes. Small changes like removed a comma doesn't require a comment, right? You don't need to tell the writer, hey, I removed a comma, you're terrible at using commas. I fixed it for you. That's not important. I'm leaving comments for basically two major things. One, I'm leaving comments when I think the writer needs more information, right? So, do you have more information about providing high quality patient-centered radiologic services? If you do, you should add it here, right? So, that is one reason I'm using comments. A second reason why I'm using comments is to explain a major change, right? So this summary was a paragraph previously. I changed it into a bulleted list. That's a major change. It's going to look different to the writer. It's going to look completely different. It's going to sound completely different. So because it's such a major change, I've left a comment and I've said, here's the change I've made. and here's why I've made that change. Okay, so as an editor, it's important for you to think through, is this a moderate change, a large change, or a small change? If it's a small change, I don't need to leave a comment. But if it's a moderate or a large change that I'm making, I need to leave a comment. Or if it's an actual question for the author, I need to leave a comment. Okay, so hopefully that's helpful for you, sort of in envisioning what it would look like to actually edit a resume. To just kind of give you an example of a fully edited resume, and to give you an example of some comments that I left that use these linguistic politeness strategies. Okay. All of this is going to be posted on the website. I'm going to post the resume with the track changes on. You can look through it and go through it at your own using your own time. I'll also post a cover letter with the edits and comments as well. Okay, so I will see you guys when I get back.